early movement. It's better than any book that's out there because Devlin has done phenomenal research that is not been done. However, no one I knew listened to it, so I thought, oh, let's do something radical. Let's actually get a group of people together to listen to something together and kind of break out of the social isolation of just listening to it on your iPod or whatever. So that was the idea behind this, and then Devlin said, oh, I could put some images with the podcast. So that's what we've got tonight. And again, it's going to be in three parts. And I want to also mention, I really want to thank Calibus, which I'm on the board of. It is a organization of men who love and have sex with men. You can't use the word gay anymore. I don't know. Or homo. And Calibus did fund Devlin's airfare out here. And while Devlin's here, he's doing more research on for the next 10 episodes of the podcast here on the Historical Society. Yay. So, before I turn over to Devlin, I did want to just mention something. This Sunday would have been the 107th birthday of Harry Hay. We call it Haymas. So we're gonna. It's amazing that this is able to happen tonight. If you did, so I'd like to introduce Devlin Hay.
Berlin was a city littered with gay and lesbian magazines. It was a city that gay novelist Christopher Isherwood would soon romanticize in his novels. 1920 Berlin was full of gay novels. There was one decorated with photos of cyclists and boxers and heated by a big, old-fashioned iron stove. The room heated up and the boys took off their leather jackets and their sweaters. They unbuttoned their shirts and rolled up their sleeves. This is technically illegal, according to paragraph 175 in the German Imperial Penal Code. But before the rise of the Third Reich, 175 is very loosely enforced. It outlaws lewd and unnatural conduct between men, but bars aren't raided very often, and few homosexuals are ever punished, though it does happen. This law is challenged by Magnus Hirschfeld and Adolf Brand, among others, but we'll put a pin in that story for another time. The point is, before Hitler's reign, Germany was pretty queer. Even someone who has seen Cabaret or read their share of Isherwood might not have thought about this. A country oblivious to, or even widely welcoming to, queer identity that has turned to hunt down and stigmatize the queer community. Anyway, I came to learn about this German bar, the Iron Stove, when I read about a man who frequented the bar during his time in Berlin in 1920. The feeling of this bar would not leave his mind when he returned to America, and he had an idea. And his ideas spread across the country in whispers. And that secret was written down on 6 pages and hidden in a desk drawer. It was strategized on the inside of the bushes. By then it was 1950 as it grew into a secret organization. Soon it would be a threat to the American government, then we would be a threat to the American family. When I began researching these activists, I only had a vague idea of the secret society of gay people who have often gone without credit for their hand in the early gay liberation movement. Though before their identities were exposed, many of them wanted to remain anonymous.
One of the standards was being picketed by a group of homosexuals.
He may have been wrong, and it may be too late when he discovered he is mentally ill.
Right now, we're being thrown out of the sex department.
Mom said the department is that we do not employ homosexuals, and that if we discover homosexuals in our department, we discharge the sickness of the mind.
It comes from nowhere, it may be from nowhere, it's from working from nowhere.
And people have to come together in order to cooperate in order to survive.
The American, in the season, acceptance of the homosexual.
Create a facade, and then behind the facade we could organize networks of sanctuaries or places where we could come and out of which we would be able to move and organize and change things across the country.
All homosexuals themselves satisfied with the way they are.
Everybody said the gays were not like that.
Now she has a podcast dedicated to exploring the overlooked, forgotten, or often untold stories in gay history. I'm Devlin Camp. A few years ago, my mentor Albert Williams and I were discussing gay history, as we often do. He teaches me quite a bit about gay history in that necessary way that young queer people like myself learn our history from older queer mentors, through stories that he lived and books he recommends. We used to sit in his office as he'd toss out book titles I should look up, such as The Persian Boy and Dancing the Gay Lib Blues. Albert, he goes by Bill, Bill told me about pre-Stonewall gay history. Something I didn't know much about, as it's an often overlooked portion of our past. The night at Stonewall, in 1969, in which trans and gay people fought back against police raiding their bar, has been spoken of with such passion and detail that the imagery entices us more so than other stories in our history. Stories like the people who tried to remain anonymous in their effort to begin the gay rights movement decades before Stonewall. Bill told me about the Mattachine Society, which met in speakeasy fashion in their living rooms, with curtains drawn and discreet meeting strategies, planning political moves and methods of bringing together an organized gay community, which didn't exist yet. The community that fought back at Stonewall in 69 was non-existent in the 1920s, 30s, 40s, at least to quote-unquote normal society. Most heterosexual people didn't know homosexual and transgender people were right there among them every day. But the queer people of the early 20th century noticed each other, the same way we see each other now. Across the room, you make eye contact. Walking down the street, you notice his gait, and you see each other. In one of the books Bill recommended to me, The City on the Pillar, Gore Vidal wrote in 1948, "Occasionally, two homosexuals might meet in the great world. When they did, by a quick glance, they acknowledged one another, and, like amused conspirators, observed the effect each was having. It was a form of Freemasonry." Some folks talk about gaydar now, but that instinctual skill wasn't discussed then. It was something only homosexuals really knew existed in public society, and so they already were a secret society. I began researching the society out of curiosity, assuming the group to be a trivial fun fact in gay history. But the story of the Mattachine Society grew into something so great and sprawling, it became difficult for me to interpret my anger at our greater society for not educating students about this extensive event in gay history, in American history. Our history helped shape the country, its politics, and then our families. And as I began to reevaluate how I view our queer community's influence on our country's history, I would come to reevaluate my own relationships and ideals in regards to the modern queer community. I knew about Stonewall and Harvey Milk, Oscar Wilde and every John Waters movie, the Gay Liberation Front, Angels in America, but some names get rejected and some files are kept sealed for far too long. Our history began centuries ago, though our American liberation began in the 20th century. That secret society, the Mattachine, was created by a factory worker named Harry Hay in 1948. But the structure of this organization was based on anonymity for the protection of their members. Anonymity is a crucial piece to this story, so today I'll tell you why Harry Hay put pen on paper to create his society, but signed his name Ian McDonald. And why anonymity? How does that work? Could a viable movement be started by pseudonyms? Did they have enough pride in being part of the community they were fighting for to put their own names on the line? Why take any social action at all if not committing your name to it? Well, Harry Hay was inspired because when two homosexuals met in the great world in 1929, like amused conspirators, one man whispered to Harry Hay a secret about an attempt to begin a society for homosexuals and just how badly things went. This week, we'll uncover that secret. We'll trace the roots of American gay liberation and the Mattachine Society back to Henry Gerber, a postal worker in 1920s Chicago. Henry Gerber will compare what he did to notorious bandits joining a thieves union. There were no organizations, no bars designated for the queer, or role models such as RuPaul or Ellen DeGeneres. whomever you might look up to. Millions of homosexuals are living against the law, and no one wants their name printed on a list for an organization of people living against the law. Henry gets his idea after going out and discovering queer culture on his own, and decides to bring it back with him to America. Henry had moved to the U.S. from Bavaria in 1913. He had no idea he was a homosexual. Hitchhiking through Kansas, he met a young farmer boy, and the boy offered Henry a ride and a job stacking wheat. When Henry arrived on the farm, he met the boy's friend, and all three of them slept together in the bunkhouse. Henry would later write, "The boys did not hesitate to invite me into their beds." It's an awakening experience for the young immigrant. A few years later, Henry is briefly institutionalized for his homosexuality, though records are unclear how this happened or for how long. He serves in the Army of Occupation in Germany after the First World War and visits Berlin often. It's there, in Berlin, that he frequents the gay bar with the old-fashioned iron stove and reads gay magazines. He's a printer and a proofreader, and a publication called Bug for Mention Wrecked hires him to write in his free time. Their name translates to Society for Human Rights. He writes a few articles for them, the translated titles of a couple being English Hypocrisy and $2 or 15 years in prison. But eventually, he must return to the United States, and he's once again restricted to the closet. What could be done about it, I thought, Henry would later write. Unlike Germany, where the homosexual was partially organized and where sex legislation was uniform for the whole country, the United States was in a condition of chaos and misunderstanding concerning its sex laws, and no one was trying to unravel the tangle and bring relief to the abused. In the early 1920s, he moves to Chicago and takes a job at the post office. Henry finds a thriving gay subculture. It's hidden in the bohemian area of the Near North Side, nicknamed Tower Town, around the old Chicago Water Tower, which still stands on Michigan Avenue today. That's where Henry meets Frank Spurk and Al Meininger, and the trio becomes good friends. He finds a glimpse of liberation again in this subculture around Tower Town, like in Berlin. The beginning of all movements is necessarily small, he'll one day write. Henry hears a call for action to bring Bummed for Mention Wrecked to the United States. His boss at the post office helps him write up a declaration of purpose for Chicago's Honor Society for Human Rights. The hardest part is finding the right people to support him. The average homosexual I found was ignorant concerning himself, Henry will later write in 1962. Others were fearful, still others were frantic or depraved. Some were blasé. Many homosexuals told me that their search for forbidden fruit was the real spice of life. With this argument, they rejected our aims. We wondered how we could accomplish anything with such resistance from our own people. But this doesn't slow him down. He has Al, his gay friend in Tower Town, and Reverend John T. Graves, a man of color and preacher who supports Henry's ideas. The plan is to get members to join the society, start a series of lectures to educate homosexuals in the public, and then start a publication to keep the community in touch with progress. Then, hopefully, they can win legal aid and legislators to eventually become open homosexuals in society. Henry writes the entire first publication named Friendship and Freedom after the German publication. He pays for the printing himself and mails it out to a small number of members. It's completely clean and free of obscenity, but many people don't want to receive it in their mail. Some of them fear their wives might see it. Though Henry and Al want exclusively homosexuals to join anyway, not bisexuals, or in many cases, homosexual men married to women hiding a secret from her and their children. Henry doesn't want secrets. He wants to create discussion, make some noise, educate the authorities to closet the community of Tower Town and Greater Chicago. They don't want closeted married men tarnishing the society's reputation. On December 10th, 1924, Henry spends $10 to file an application to issue a nonprofit corporation charter in Illinois. The society forms to promote the interests of people who, by reasons of mental and physical abnormalities, are abused and hindered by the legal pursuit of happiness, which is guaranteed to them by the Declaration of Independence. The Reverend John Graves signs his true name as president, Al signs as vice president, and Henry Gerber signs as secretary. The charter is issued on Christmas Eve, 1924. Yes, they sign their real names, and no one seems to investigate the group's purpose. Henry intentionally doesn't write about sexuality on the application. The word homosexual isn't even widely used yet. But still, this is the earliest documented homosexual emancipation organization in the United States. And with no one noticing, they get to work. printing Friendship and Freedom, seeking new members, contacting doctors, but every medical professional refuses to wager their reputation on endorsing the society or the publication. Only poor homosexuals want to join because they have nothing to lose, and Henry will pay for it all. It's an uphill fight, and at the end of long days of work and looking for members, the three of them each go their separate ways. Henry to his apartment, John to his house, and Al to his wife and children. One Sunday morning, at about 2 a.m., Henry Gerber returns home from a trip downtown. He goes to his room and hears a knock at the door. Must be the landlady. He opens the front door and two men shove their way in. One says he's a detective for the city, the other a newspaper reporter from the Hearst paper, The Examiner. The detective looks around and asks Henry, "Where's the boy?" Henry asks, "What boy?" He has orders from his captain, the detective explains, to bring Henry down to the station. The cop grabs Henry's typewriter, his notary public diploma, bookkeeping accounts, the literature for Henry's Society for Human Rights, and his personal diaries. There is no warrant for his arrest, no charges made against Henry, but they came in the night and took him away. The police, I suppose, had hoped or expected to find us in bed. They could not imagine homosexuals in any other way. Henry will come to find out that during step one of creating this organization, the search for members, Al's wife had discovered his secret. Henry and John didn't know their society's vice president had a wife or two children. Like I mentioned before, they don't want gay men married to women to join their group, or bisexuals, which is frustrating. When Al's wife discovers the publications and the Society for Human Rights, she phones a social worker about Al's organization of quote-unquote degenerates. The social worker contacts the police to report these quote-unquote strange doings, and the police contact a reporter. When morning comes, Henry is allowed to call his boss at the post office, who kindly declares him absent on leave, so he won't be in trouble for the arrest. The police take him down to the Chicago Avenue police court in a car full of strangers. When he walks in, he finds Al Meininger, John Graves, and a young man found in Al's room during the arrest. None of them know exactly what's going to happen. They wait. Henry chats with a friendly cop who shows him the morning paper. Henry takes the examiner in his hands and reads the headline. Strange sex cult exposed. He reads through the article, which details how Al Meininger brought his male friends home and had a full view of his wife and children practice strange sex acts with them. The reporter explains the pamphlet he found for this cult, which urged men to leave their wives and children. It goes on to tell the story as if the preacher and the postal worker were arrested along with Al in his bedroom last night. Henry feels betrayed, later referring to Al as an indignant laundry queen, which I think is a brilliant read. Monday, the day after the arrest, Henry goes to court. The detective presents a powder puff as evidence, claiming to have found it in Henry's room. The social worker reads from Henry's diary a single line out of context, "I love Carl." The judge shudders. This is the case against the leader. The state attorney turns to Henry and asks, "Does Society for Human Rights stand for the right of you swine to fuck boys in the ass?" To the already prejudiced court, "We were obviously guilty," Henry writes. "We were guilty just by being homosexual." The judge barely speaks to them, closing with a comment that they have violated federal law for sending their obscene newsletter through the mail, and they are dismissed to Cook County Jail. John is separated from Henry and Al in jail while they wait for a second trial set for that Thursday. Al breaks down crying in his cell, feeling guilty for getting them into this. A prisoner who takes notice connects Henry with a shyster lawyer that takes on criminal cases. The case looks serious, according to that lawyer, but he says he can get them out on bail for $200. Henry can just pay the maximum fine of $200 and go free, back home and back to work at the post office. But he takes up the lawyer's offer instead. Thursday, Henry walks into court to see two post office inspectors. They're prepared to have the federal commissioner take the case from the obscenity angle for sending Friendship and Freedom through the United States Postal Service. Friendship and Freedom doesn't depict any sex acts, it's just pro-homosexuality. The attorney argues that they should be released and that a powder puff is not evidence. The judge gets angry and threatens the attorney with contempt, ultimately adjourning the trial until Monday. Henry's attorney makes one more request for bail, and the judge thinks about it and sets bail for $1,000 each. So the lawyer agrees to that and also collects his fees. Henry is broke, but free. The next day, he returns to work at the post office to find that he's been suspended by the postal inspectors. He calls the Examiner, the newspaper that reported his arrest, and they assure him that corrections will be made, but of course, nothing happens. He looks into a new lawyer that will help him get his job back, a lawyer that will again cost him $200. The lawyer arranges for Henry's case to be put on the docket of another judge, who is rumored to be queer. There is a third trial. There's the new judge, the arresting detective, prosecuting attorney, the two postal inspectors, and even the first lawyer is there to watch after developing an interest in Henry's case. The new judge is upset by the arrests made without a warrant, calling it an outrage. He dismisses the case. Al pleads guilty to disorderly conduct and is fined $10. The judge orders Henry's things to be returned, but he only gets his typewriter back. The postal inspectors never return his diaries. Henry spent more than his life savings on the case. His lawyer says he can get him his job back, but Henry is out of money to pursue it. Shortly after, he receives a letter in the mail from Washington telling him he's been dismissed for conduct unbecoming a postal worker. Henry will later write, "That definitely meant the end of the Society for Human Rights." He becomes bitter that no affluent homosexual came to help him. He'll write, "Most bitches are only interested in sex contacts." He wants to free homosexuals for their own good and for his, and he'll one day write that he wants to become the Moses of our community. But by signing his name on the application to take on this role, he had welcomed his society's own undoing. When they read his name, they took everything from him. Henry packs up and moves to New York City. New York City, 1925, is full of speakeasies, subway tea rooms, nightclubs, and Turkish baths. There are masquerade balls of homosexuals and a lesbian tea room run by Eve Adams, known as the Queen of the Third Sex. She has a sign on the door stating, "Men are admitted, but not welcome." Who lives in Greenwich Village on East 11th Street? Meanwhile, across the country in Los Angeles, word of Henry's failed organization spreads, planting the seeds of a movement. In the early 1930s, you might thumb through the Saturday Review of Literature, as many people do. You might see an ad for a service called Contacts. Contacts proclaims itself the only correspondence club for the mentally marooned, and it lists descriptions of people seeking pen pals, heterosexual or otherwise. It doesn't specify who should write in. Anyone can. And a young man named Manuel Boyfrink does, as this is a modern way of connecting with people. The letters go in, and someone assigns a number to each contactor and matches people up with other people they think they would connect with. Manuel's letter goes to the creator of the service, who is listed as Merlin Wand. Of course, that's a pseudonym. Manuel's letter arrives in the mailbox of Henry Gerber. Henry understands Manuel's loneliness, and they both know what this service is really for. Lonely queer people looking to connect, and perhaps sometimes it's a cruising tactic. And Henry, anonymously running contacts, doesn't connect Manuel with another number because he feels like making contact with Manuel himself. So he writes him back. Henry is connecting other lonely queer people, though, even if their letters don't explicitly state their sexuality. They can read between the lines to understand what is truly being said, what the service is really for. It's tactics like these that teach homosexuals a secret language of subtext. For example, let me read some of what Henry Gerber's profile says. Contactor number 10, NYC male, 44, proofreader, single. Favored by nature with immunity to female charms, but this is not considers them necessary in the scheme of nature. Amused by screwy antics of Homo sapiens, introvert, enjoying a quiet evening with classical music or nonfiction book, looking at life, I understand why monkeys protested Darwin's theory. A couple paragraphs down, while discussing his opinions on sexual morality, he says, birth control makes slow headway, but is considered legal, although natural forms of birth control, which do not depend on artificial goods sold in drugstores, are still considered grave moral misdemeanors. Any reader just scanning through this bio might not detect that natural forms of birth control means homosexual sex. It goes on to write the usual interests you might find in a personal about me page, but put quite simply, he's looking for someone intelligent who forms opinions about the world on their own without being led by religion or society, and perhaps he's finding that in Manuel Boy Frank. Henry and Manuel have no way of knowing for sure what sort of fellow they might be contacting. Number 10 could be anyone on the receiving end, essentially catfishing number 1344, but Manuel trusts the letters. Henry dedicates his time to the dating service until it flourishes to nearly 1,500 members. This is a way of doing the Society for Human Rights over again, safely, anonymously, and getting something real for himself. Contact. Approximately 200 letters are exchanged between these two men. They discuss Henry's Society for Human Rights, many books Henry's writing, pseudonyms, and the groundwork for organizing homosexuals. Manuel tells Henry stories of growing up part Cherokee in turn-of-the-century Oklahoma territory, where he became a cowboy the same year Henry was moving to America. He writes to Henry about how, with little opportunity for sexual adventure that existed in cities like Chicago, some cowboys paired off and became close. Manuel recalls that this didn't have to be seen between the two men as a homosexual issue or something to feel guilty about. And it's later out on these same farmlands and prairies that Alfred Kinsey will record the highest occurrences of homosexual behavior compared to the rest of the country. But let's put a pin in that until next week. Henry connects Manuel to another contactor, number 1744, Frank McCourt, a 36-year-old man, and the three of them develop a conversation. Frank has been collecting a huge sexology library of books and photographs in his home, some bought through German magazine mail orders and similar channels. He teaches Manuel about homosexual literature, Whitman, Wilde, Greek ethics, and so on. The trio continues to talk about the future of the homosexual, how to organize safely, with Henry already well experienced in just how quickly an organization can go south. There's a lot of start and stop on several ideas, not just with these three men. Presumably all over the world, questionnaires and letters and pamphlets and photos and sex groups, all sorts of correspondence is written in the same way Henry and his friends are trying to bring about gay liberation. There are many disconnected homosexuals seeking the same type of organization that will never know of each other and will never be recorded. Letter chains, clubs, disguised as science fiction clubs, chess clubs, or book clubs, all unaware of each other, just a reason to gather and talk. And it's likely that evidence of their existence is intentionally destroyed by them to hide their secret. With many men being shipped off, Frank McCourt presumes that a growing viable movement will have to be a post-war effort. 9 years of Henry Gerber's dating service called Contacts goes by. He becomes tired of being used as a hookup service. He's still in the army and knows it's risky to continue, so in 1939, he ends Contacts. During its run, the discussion these three men had foreshadowed the discussions that will be held by the Mad Machine. Discussions held behind closed curtains and locked doors in the living rooms of people using pseudonyms with a group of gay strangers. Manuel writes to Henry about the need for propaganda to make their case. They discuss seeking the support of medical authorities to fight the agreed diagnosis of homosexuality as a psychological disorder. They talk about contacting the press with educational literature, all things that will come in time. Henry pitches the idea of a club created by gay men by listing their past lovers, using real sex to grassroots the movement. Frank offers up his photo collection to share within the group. Manuel perseveres with ideas for organization, but Henry ultimately still feels uncomfortable forming what he calls a society of queers. So Frank pulls back and spends time on his collection and hosting weekend orgies in his home. On August 5th, 1944, Henry writes to Manuel and Frank, "I want to work from the top down, and you want to work from the bottom up. I can never agree to that. In other words, you went to enlighten the people as to sex, while I went to enlighten the authorities that persecution of homosexuals is antisocial and unjust and hypocritical as long as the perversions of heterosexuals are not punished. The only difference is that my plan can bring some results, while your plan can only put you in jail. The three men write for years, never quite settling on an agreement. Another harbinger of the movement to come. Outside of the letters, Henry continues to work for the cause. He writes to periodicals such as The Modern Thinker, defending homosexuality against doctors and psychoanalysts. In one instance of this, his reply to an essay, which is published by the periodical, he argues back that if homosexuals are disturbed by insecurity, antisocial behavior, or criminal tendencies, then the homosexual has been made so by societal oppression. After all, Henry writes, refuting that essay, it is highly futile for Dr. Wolfe to worry about neurotic homosexuals when the world itself, led and ruled by strong heterosexual, quote-unquote, normal men, is in such chaotic condition and knows not where to turn. He also serves as circulation manager for a magazine called Chanticleer, writing under the pseudonym Parasex. Henry writes about homosexual literature and his eloquently argued position against monogamy as a construct created by priests and politicians. And he writes about Hitler's murder of homosexuals such as Ernst Röhm and other SA officers. He also does book reviews, and he's got a knack for wisecracking reviews of what he calls anti-homosexual propaganda. Actually, here are a couple clips from those book reviews. Twilight Men by André Tellier deals with a young Frenchman who comes to America, introduced into homosexual society in New York, becomes a drug addict for no obvious reason, finally kills his father and commits suicide. It is again excellent anti-homosexual propaganda, although the plot is too silly to convince anyone who has known homosexual people at all. Strange Brother by Blair Niles is the story of a sensitive young man. The author causes him to go through as many mental sufferings as she can, then puts a pistol in his hand and lets him shoot himself and ends the book. Again, an ideal anti-homosexual propaganda, but no more logical than the book mentioned before. So shade really does come from reading. Henry Manuel and Frank's correspondence begins to fizzle out because of different opinions. Frank wants a sort of sex-obsessed hedonic church. Henry wants to organize a secret underground legal assistance group, and Manuel wants to revive contacts. They disagree on everything down to the name of their group, which Manuel pushes to be something like Dorian Society. Doric, or Dorian, being a Greek word sometimes used in the gay community to mean gay. Manuel knows the group's name has to be a word that takes on meaning, not just an acronym or official group title. The word has to represent the movement. Across the country, in Los Angeles, a young man named Harry Hay crosses a downtown street into Pershing Square, a park of overgrown trees and a common place for homosexual men to cruise for anonymous sex. There are a few other options for men to meet each other. Harry locks eyes with a man he later learns is named Champ Simmons. Champ is a little older, and the two begin meeting indoors. He's surprised to learn Harry is only 17 and, as Harry will later put it, jailbait, for two reasons. Champ teaches Harry a great deal about being a homosexual. He tells Harry that he has been brought up by a man involved in a secret society in Chicago called the Society for Human Rights. Harry will later recall,
Champ thought it would be a bit too dangerous. The failure of the Chicago group should be a direct warning to anyone trying to do anything like that again.
But Harry hears the warning as inspiration. Frank LaCourte goes on to create the U.S. Rocket Society, a science fiction club where homosexuals can discreetly gather. The letters between Henry and Manuel are considered by historian Jonathan Katz as no doubt one of the most valuable collections of original gay American history manuscripts that will ever be found. Those letters will be preserved by a man who will soon watch the Madison closely as he gathers pamphlets, clippings, and correspondence all over Los Angeles. But we'll talk more about Jim Kettner. These stories of what happened to Henry Gerber after his arrest don't just explain how difficult it is for a gay person to make contact with another gay person before organizations and explicitly gay bars are established. Though I did read the book reviews only because I think they're hilarious. But these stories say so much more about Henry, because with all the drive he had to continue helping his community, he never did anything as bold as the Society for Human Rights ever again. How are the people of Henry's service called contacts connecting and meeting? Anonymously. Everyday people longing for contact with someone like them, but needing to remain a citizen in good standing with jobs and homes and parents and friends. By putting his name on the line, losing all of his money, his job, and even needing to move to a new city to start fresh, Henry was understandably changed. If you read about Henry, many historians refer to him in this time after his arrest as grumpy and crotchety. Earlier, I asked, why anonymity? Anonymity will become the key piece to putting together action and keeping your job, your savings, family, home. Anonymity makes it possible to take action and keep your life when trying to live your life is the whole point of taking action. Many other stories follow the legacy of Henry Gerber. He was once mugged in New York City, and Henry tracked down his mugger and pressed charges. His lawyer had the trial postponed 5 times, thinking Henry wouldn't show up. But the jury convicted for assault in the third degree, and then Henry wrote to Manuel, I wanted to prove to myself that it does not pay to rob a dork, because he is such. They take it for granted that we are too cowardly to fight for our rights. Homosexuals of the time are not only beaten, robbed, and blackmailed, but they're still harassed by postal monitors who report them to the police. In February 1942, Henry's living space is searched by the U.S. Army's investigative unit. They find no evidence, not even a powder puff, and he's still forced to spend weeks in the guardhouse until he's put before a Section 8 board in their attempt to kick him out of the Army. And he'll later write, when I told the president of the board I only practiced mutual masturbation with men over 21, the psychiatrist told me, you are not a homosexual. I nearly fell out of my chair. Imagine me fighting all my life for our cause and then be told I was not a homosexual. He spends the rest of his time at the U.S. Soldiers' Home in Washington, D.C., writing his never-published book, Moral Delusions. Manuel continues to attempt to organize a homosexual in North Hollywood. In another letter, Frank writes to Henry about Manuel, saying, he has so many grand ideas, and somehow nothing comes of them. Frank manages the Rocketeer's sci-fi club as his health declines. The letters and photographs slow. Henry no longer wants Frank's photos because he gets, quote, no more joy in looking at pictures than does a squirrel from looking on an advertisement of planters' nuts. Frank, of course, will later experience some trouble with postal inspectors, too. It wasn't long after Henry left Germany that the National Socialist Party became bent on exterminating homosexuals there. Gays were just one small part of their agenda, of course. Hitler was appointed chancellor, and the Reichstag German parliament building was burned, allegedly by a communist. Citing the arson at the Reichstag as proof that communists were scheming against the German government, Hitler used the fire to urge the president to have his communist political opponents arrested. Their seats vacated, the Nazi Party rose to power. The Nazi Party enforced the arrests of homosexuals by cracking down on that relatively overlooked paragraph 175, a law already on the books. Der Eigene, the leading gay magazine, stopped publishing. Its editor had tried to challenge paragraph 175 with Magnus Hirschfeld, whose institute that inspired Henry Gerber while living in Germany was now raided and torn apart. 4 days later, in Opera Square, Hirschfeld's books, case reports, charts, and files and photographs, all his research, was burned publicly. A bust of Magnus Hirschfeld was carried by torchlight and tossed to the flames by Nazi supporters. The crowd cheered. The country and the culture that inspired Henry Gerber to take action in America was dismantled by the Nazi Party after they rose to power by using a communist as a scapegoat. This is how the liberation of queer German people was stopped dead in its tracks. Henry Gerber and his organization in America were also stopped in their tracks. But because Henry heard the call to action, another leading activist will soon hear the call too. Magnus Hirschfeld had written years before, in 1927, all efforts aimed at creating a mass organization of homosexuals have, in the end, failed. Aside from a few minor cliques, homosexuals are in reality almost totally lacking in feelings of solidarity. In fact, it would be difficult to find another class of mankind which has proved so incapable of organizing to secure its basic legal and human rights. Henry grows cold to the movement. He's been hurt too many times and rarely finds anyone besides Manuel with whom he can agree. As a homosexual, he isn't even able to write in his own diary without having it used against him in court. I have few illusions left, he writes. I no longer believe in martyrdom for the sake of others. He writes to Manuel in 1944. Jesus is said to have died for mankind, but look at them now, 2,000 years later, worse than ever. Jesus could have had a good time with his 12 boyfriends in the Garden of Gethsemane instead the dopey bitch wanted to save others. And although Henry Gerber took a step back from the gay liberation movement, this won't quite be the last we'll hear from him. Because, as I mentioned, Henry's story quietly spread across the country to Los Angeles, where a young man named Harry Hay hears about his history from a stranger in a park. And nearly 20 years after meeting that man in the park, in the Los Angeles neighborhood of Silver Lake, 38-year-old Harry Hay arrives home from his manufacturing job to his wife and two daughters. He opens the New York Times to find that the State Department is weeding out homosexuals from government work. He knows that soon factories contracted by the government, like the one he works for, will start to weed out homosexuals too. And with the story of Henry Gerber still clear in his mind, Harry Hay hears the call. Suddenly my world was transformed into a whole wonderful different place because my night dream and daydream fantasies from then on would always include him, the one who is going to be everything to me, as I naturally would be to him. Welcome to Madison. 1948. Harry Hay works at Leahy Manufacturing, 23 years after Henry Gerber's short-lived secret society in Chicago, featured in last week's episode. On the job, in the factory, a co-worker takes Harry Hay aside quietly. The FBI has been asking around about you, he tells Harry. They knew all about you, he says. Which secret do they know? That Harry Hay is a communist? That his wife is? And when she's not around, Harry cruises the park for men when he's able? It's where he had heard about the failed secret society in Chicago. It was another furtive encounter with someone like him, revealing a piece of shared history. For years, this has been happening to Harry. At 14 years old and 6'2", he looked old enough to get into a union, so he worked a tramp steamer full of men from San Francisco to Los Angeles. He had just left the Nevada hayfields his father sent him to work, worrying he had spawned a sissy. Spawn being his father's choice word. On the tramp steamer, before he even left the dock, Harry had his first sexual experience with a man. Laying in a lifeboat, the 25-year-old man he just met was surprised to learn Harry's real age, 14. The man told Harry about his experiences traveling to other countries on ships like this. He said that they're part of a silent brotherhood that exists all over the world, a hidden society of people who can recognize each other. Harry knows the danger of openly being a minority. It's rather commonplace that he and his father were once forced to the roadside by local Ku Klux Klan members to watch a cross burn. He understands very young that it's dangerous to be considered different. He remains a silent member of his group, off and on, for more than 20 years. But he later separates his sexuality from his politics. But then his political party attracts hatred too. With fear of communist espionage rising, the US government hunts down political radicals. So the Communist Party has its members structured in a clandestine cell system. That's a system that keeps levels of membership separate in order to keep everyone anonymous to each other and safe from infiltration. Harry separates his life similarly for similar reasons. While one secret the FBI might know about Harry might ruin his life, another secret won't keep down thousands. Best to keep his secrets separate. But Harry knows what the FBI must have been asking his factory co-worker about. He's certain his coworker must be referring to his membership of the Communist Party. Or has the FBI figured out that this communist they're tracking, Harry Hay, is the leader of the gay organization causing trouble in a completely separate case file of the Bureau labeled Madison Foundation, aka Madison Society?
This week on Madison.
If I didn't live in the box, and if he didn't live in the box, maybe we could come to. We can help you fall upon us in a relationship. There were a lot of things that my father said were wrong that I knew were. I figured that they were wrong, too. But because I had no way of telling, it didn't mean that I was wrong. It only meant that I had no way of telling. But I intend to be a homosexual, and I intend to find out exactly what this life is going to be.
Mashing is a podcast dedicated to exploring the overlooked, forgotten, or often untold stories in gay history. I'm Devlin Camp. Harry Gay was born in Worthing, England, and moved to Los Angeles with his parents in 1917. As a young man, he reads Edward Carpenter's The Intermediate Sex in the library, and he realizes that same-sex love isn't just his private fantasy.
I'm aware of the fact that living one life in San Francisco on weekends and living another life at Stanford.
I should tell you that while I will have some voice actors on this show, the clips you'll hear of Harry Hay today are really hairy from recordings courtesy of the One Archives at USC Library. So, Harry starts at Stanford University shortly after hearing about Henry Gerber's Society from the Man in the Park, which we talked about in our previous episode.
I began to discover that, making contact with people was not as hard as I thought it was. Almost immediately, you learned the eye language. And there were a lot of wild tales floating around in the 30s, which by this time, Chandler told me about. The ones wearing a red tie, which was one of them, and, well, and of course, the usual cruising techniques, and asking for a match, asking for the time, all that stuff. Then I found that the eye language was marvelous, so I used that. At 17, I was looking for love and finding tricks. I did find that at Stanford that it was not difficult, and I was also learning about the fickleness and the way men are heartbreaking me.
For instance, it's confusing for Harry when a young man he's seeing romantically doesn't return to school in the fall.
And then I got a feeling that he didn't come back because of our relationship. And I didn't understand that at all. No, it's because I can't be honest. Because we have to keep pretending and we have to keep lying. If only we could come out of the box, and he could come out of the box, everything would just fine. So I thought, well, the least I can do is I can come out of the box. I don't know what it means, I have no idea. But I intend to be a homosexual and I intend to find out exactly what this life is going to be like. So the best thing to do is to say who I am.
So he tells his closest friends.
I told them on a Wednesday, you know, on a Wednesday, whatever they are, simply said, okay, so does that mean we can't see you? And I said, no. And they said, well, when you want to go away to San Francisco, you just tell us in advance and maybe we'll plan anything for that weekend.
And just to go the extra mile, he tells all his clubs.
The club said that if you want to go on eating here, it's all right. But the people in the club got to the place where, you know, there would be empty space on either side of where I have to be sitting to eat. Because I apparently rubbed off, you know. They were afraid of mine. And a lot of guys whom I've known for many, many years here in Los Angeles all sort of said, well, you know, it doesn't make any difference to us, but there, some of the people we know might think it was, well, they might ask some embarrassing questions, so you don't mind if we don't come around quite so often. And I said, you know, sure, okay, whatever you have to do.
Oh, and just to be sure everyone knows, he tells his teachers.
The guy who was ahead of ground department said, sitting in the which is that network, you're not that Juliet. And I said, oh, no.
Harry leaves Stanford early to return to L.A., though not because of issues being openly gay. In Los Angeles, he meets famous closeted men, many of whom find him too flamboyant for their anonymity. But Harry cruises around and makes some friends through Will Gear, a well-known actor who would become Harry's lover. By the way, Will is later on a hit CBS show in the 1970s called The Waltons. He teaches Harry about the Communist Party and radical activism. Together, they support labor strikes, such as the 83-day West Coast waterfront strike of 1934. Harry soon joins an agitation propaganda group of players who perform agitprop on the streets at protests. This is a type of political theater meant to inspire activism, and Harry is nearly arrested multiple times. He's attending communist meetings, getting along with the people, and he finally joins the Communist Party. It's ironic that Harry's sexuality brought him to the Communist Party because the party opposes homosexuality. Not knowing that he's gay, fellow communist Anita Blackie becomes close with Harry, and in 1938, they marry. Harry and Anita adopt two girls and move to a hillside house overlooking the water of Silver Lake in Los Angeles. And the baby goes by. Harry works manufacturing jobs and teaches folk music history at the People's Education Center, where many communists are studying in the 1940s.
I had isolated myself in prison. I didn't have a prison contact in prison. And I did some groups.
Meanwhile, an informant for the FBI discovers a letter. This informant, whoever they are, steals a copy of this letter after it's sent to the Los Angeles Communist Party Membership Committee. It's a letter from a member requesting readmission into the party under a new pseudonym. A pseudonym quite similar to the one I told you about last week, the one Harry would use in his own organization, Ian McDonald. That letter to the Communist Party, now handed over to the FBI, is from Harry. The FBI seeks out the letter's author. They take photos of Harry. They look into his wife. They even dig up that he has been treated for syphilis, which really confirms to them that he must be subversive. To them, syphilis shows weak moral character. Harry's name and the letter are placed on FBI Director J. Edgar Hoover's Custodial Detention Index. That index is a list of people of Italian, German, and communist sympathies. According to the FBI, these people should be detained in the event of war. But because the FBI can't legally detain anyone, the Attorney General had Director Hoover close down that index. But Hoover simply just renames the index the Security Index, and Harry's name remains on that list for years to come. The Bureau intends to watch his every move. They place a mail cover on his house, watching all incoming and outgoing letters. A member of Harry's own family in Wisconsin writes to the FBI that Harry and his wife are holding communist meetings in their home. FBI replies with contact info for the Milwaukee Special Agent in Charge should she have any future information. And now, the FBI waits for Harry Hay to cause trouble. But Harry spends his free time creating his folk music history class that teaches his students how music creates social change. Like I mentioned, he enjoys political theater.
And how it develops out of the social context and social struggles of people, and how it relates to struggle, or how it doesn't relate to struggle, how it relates to change, how it doesn't relate to change. And that's going to take a bit of study. And I found out that I've taken all part of life.
And his ties to the Communist Party and his teachings can't keep him away from homosexuals. He inevitably sees this, quote-unquote, silent brotherhood wherever he goes.
And I was dealing with artists and writers, I was dealing with musicians, and I'm aware of the fact that I'm dealing with gay people again. And all of a sudden I recognize that the leadership is. And yet we don't have a language that is not communicating as gay people, but we are communicating as sort of people who understand each other, because we're all in the party. And in sort of sense,
he also has gay co-workers. Harry's gay co-worker Bill has a friend who worked as a secretary in the State Department. One day in the late 40s, Bill's friend comes to town and visits Bill and Harry for lunch at the factory. He tells them all about what's happening in Washington, what Harry had seen on TV and read in the New York Times. He tells Harry, everybody's terrified. This man has been watching all the homosexual men in his department disappear, and he finally figured out that many people who were fired had slept with Andrew, a beautiful new employee who was reassigned to D.C. from another city. It weighs on Harry's mind, his quiet minority now discovered by the U.S. government. That's not to say heterosexuals don't know homosexuals exist, but now the government is recognizing them and doing something about them.
I begin to recognize that somehow or other, my time as a heterosexual, I see that heterosexual is coming to me.
But Harry's still committed to the party and committed to teaching his music class. All the while, his search for music recordings keeps him constantly networking with other closeted men.
And then comes the new bus for Los Angeles for you. So, one of the guys whom I like very much had this party one night. He lived over in New York City. And so he said, come on over, there are a couple of the guys I'm having lunch with a priest from the seminary, but he's going to a seat from the and he knows quite a lot about French papers, he can make sure to find out what he wants. So I go to this party for this, and then all the
they drink, and he stays around chatting, and conversation slowly drifts to the recent Kinsey statistic released that 37% of men had had a homosexual experience. It's breaking news that Dr. Albert Kinsey has discovered 1 out of 10 men are homosexual, which fascinates the crowd at this party. Harry believes this means there's a possibility that these people can be determined a minority capable of organizing. And with Henry Wallace running for president that year on a campaign promising to end racial segregation, Harry thinks they might even be able to be represented at a Democratic convention. This is a time of great change for the Democratic Party, shifting to a party of social change and identity politics.
We could maybe get the Progressive Party to stop hounding the guys in the State Department. Simply let people be what they want to be.
Harry and the boys up late drinking, pitching names for their group.
For time's sake, I'm American, how could we possibly present to the American public? Because the only thing we can do is call ourselves fascists. We've got to keep it doing. We're going to be aware of reaching other differences around the country, might be a signal.
They land on Bachelors for Wallace in order to get Henry Wallace's attention in his run for the presidency.
I don't think I ever got a chance to talk about his stuff and choices. I think that got lost.
Harry goes home excited about the possibilities. He stays up late writing a 5-page prospectus for the Bachelors for Wallace. It's titled Preliminary Concepts for International Bachelors, Fraternal Orders for Peace and Social Dignity. But more simply, he nicknamed the essay The Call.
I ended up writing what amounted to a call for what would amount to a permanent organization.
He later wrote, I realized that we had been contributive in various ways over the millennia, and I felt that we could return to being contributive again. Then we could be respected for our differences, not for our samenesses to heterosexuals. The next day, he contacts the host of last night's party for everyone's phone numbers. He makes calls saying,
and it's not only Bachelors for Wallace, but an incorporation to incorporate a whole larger idea of movement that we can have in the world. And let's get together tomorrow night and begin to work on it.
But he finds that no one seems to remember this conversation about Bachelors for Wallace. Or if they do, they pretty much tell him the idea is nuts. He responds that they can try to get ministers and psychologists to approve of their work, and then they look a little crazy. But then, upon contacting these types of professionals, they tell Harry they might consider such a group if he starts one first. Professionals want a group first, potential group members want professionals to endorse the group before they join it. Harry's ideas remain nothing but ideas on paper. But just up the road, in Burbank, a secretary writing under the name Lisa Ben is distributing her underground lesbian magazine, Vice Versa. In Los Angeles, Merton Bird is forming Knights of the Clock, a group for interracial gay couples. Harry isn't alone. He just doesn't know that yet. Gay Los Angeles. Gay LA of the early 1950s has cruising spots well known in gay circles. The Long Beach Navy Yard, Crystal Baths near the Santa Monica Pavilion, Pershing Square, north of Hollywood Boulevard, their neighborhoods known for many lesbian tenants. Gay culture is privately thriving, and Harry is privately enjoying it. But soon the outside government influence will crack down, and Harry's two worlds will have to collide. What Harry and most people don't know yet is that in the late 1940s, about 100 homosexuals per year are fired from federal jobs. This is because of the McCarran Rider, which allows the Secretary of State to fire any employee at his absolute discretion for national security. The McCarran Rider is able to be used for homosexuals and communists alike, but we'll put a pin in that story for another day, specifically 2 weeks from now. For people in general, gays and reds are similar for many reasons. Gays and reds are similar because they both keep secret identities. They both have an underworld culture. They seem loyal to their group. They both have, or will have, publications and meeting places. Paranoia will grow until the government firings increase from 100 per year to about 1 a day in the mid-50s. It's hard to trace exactly how many there are because most dismissals are reported as volunteer resignations or the employee faces being outed. This heats up in February 1950. Senator Joseph McCarthy gives a now famous speech in February 1950. It's about why the nation is seemingly losing the Cold War. He announces that 205 card-carrying communists are working in the State Department. During this time, the Red Scare, it isn't a new thing to say that communists are working in the government, but it is a new thing to announce that there is a list. 11 days later, on the Senate floor, McCarthy names two cases as examples in which he blurs the lines between homosexuality and communism, as people often do. Harry Hay believes McCarthy is looking for a new scapegoat. Harry believes that because the black community is already organized and Jewish people were too recently persecuted in the Holocaust, that McCarthy is looking to get away with placing blame on the relatively unknown and unrecognizable homosexuals. Harry later said, "It was obvious McCarthy was setting up the pattern for a new scapegoat, and it was going to be us, gays. We had to organize. We had to move. We had to get started." Harry's right. The Red Scare of communism brings paranoia, because the American government demands patriotism, unconditional loyalty. Sound familiar? When the government needs to weed out communists, they have everyone on the watch for anything atypical of the husband, wife, 2.5 kids, a pet, and a white picket fence. The government justifies the firing of homosexuals by pushing the idea that gays are at risk for blackmail. The government believes that the enemy, Russia, can hold a gay person's sexual secret against them for American secrets from that homosexual's government job. And perhaps it's unintentional, but by blurring the lines between communism and homosexuality as similar security risks, Joseph McCarthy boosts the witch hunt for gays and government jobs. This catalyzes what will become labeled the Lavender Scare. The Lavender Scare will run long past the lifetime of the McCarthyist hunt for communists.
March 1st, 1950. The New York Times reports that since 1947, 91 people have resigned from the State Department while under investigation as security risks. And I quote, "Most of these were homosexuals." The Times will continue reporting throughout the month on Senator McCarthy's work to weed out homosexuals in government jobs. He calls them perverts and says they are security risks because they are subject to blackmail. Senator Kenneth Wherry also believes this to be a moral and security issue. He says, quote, "You can't hardly separate homosexuals from subversives. Mind you, I don't say every homosexual is a subversive, and I don't say every subversive is a homosexual. But a man of low morality is a menace in the government, whatever he is, and they are all tied up together." End quote. Now, back to you.
Harry is angry. He's angry that no political power, especially the political party he believes in, has taken a stand against the homosexual witch hunt. The minority Harry finds himself in is truly, politically, on its own. Summer, July 8, 1950. Harry attends his daughter's rehearsal at the Lester Gordon Dance Theater, where performances often have themes of political injustice. He sits down to watch his daughter dance.
And in the audience,
Harry immediately falls for Rudy, an Austrian refugee who at 16 escaped his country with his mother after Nazi Germany and
I know immediately that this is somebody I have to show my experience to.
Now 28, this man, Rudy, agrees to meet Harry for dinner at a restaurant in the Sunset Strip called the Chuck Wagon.
And I can't believe my good fortune that I never expected that such a beautiful creature would ever pass into my life.
Before the dinner, Harry rewrites his prospectus, The Call, which he had redrafted occasionally over the past couple of years. He arrives at the Chuck Wagon and takes the table with Rudy. He slides the document over for Rudy to read. "Preliminary Concepts, copyrighted by Ian McDonald," it says. Harry Sugman. Rudy skims through The Call to "Society's Androgynous Minority." Harry wrote about homosexuals ruthlessly exterminated in the Holocaust. He worried of encroaching American fascism, which seeks to bend unorganized and unpopular minorities into isolated fragments. He wrote, "Government indictments against androgynous civil servants lies in the legal establishment of a type of guilt by association, which the accused cannot disprove." which means that if the government succeeds in attacking homosexuals, it has a weapon that can be employed as a threat against any and every man and woman in our country to ensure thought control and political regimentation. According to historian John D'Amelio, what Harry wrote made it imperative for homosexuals to organize. Harry also stresses caution moving forward, a system of membership by recommendation only, in which members are sworn to secrecy and remain anonymous to the community and to each other for their own protection. It becomes clear, Rudy, that Harry prophesied something many homosexuals didn't, that the guilt by association strategies the government is using could spread into the private enterprise. For example, Harry and many of his co-workers are employed by aircraft manufacturers. Those manufacturers have government contracts. Southern California is full of these government jobs in the 1940s and 50s. Harry sees a future where working class homosexuals will find it impossible to get work because so many jobs are government funded. Like Henry Gerber, fired from the post office. If this McCarthyist scapegoating thrives, homosexuals will be unable to survive. The document continues for 6 pages, finally saying, "We, the androgynes of the world, have formed this responsible corporate body to demonstrate by our efforts that our physiological and psychological handicaps need to be no deterrent in integrating 10% of the world's population towards the constructive social progress of mankind." Rudy looks up at Harry, and he says, "It's the most dangerous thing I've ever seen, and I'm with you 100%. He takes it home and reads it thoroughly.
He gives me a call the next day and says, "It's wonderful when we begin. I have a whole lot of prospects of which you're going to die. At least 50 times when you want." And you know, that company was the most important day that I had to meet. And all of a sudden, somebody else said, "No."
They're planning within a week.
And I also add that by number 9, I am hopeless. Utterly, totally hopeless. And I know there's all kinds of changes that have to take place in my pressure how it's all going to go, but this is the most important thing that's ever happened to me, and I am ready to draw all caution to the winds.
But they do begin organizing slowly. Rudy knows of Magnus Hirschfeld's attempts to educate society, which were stamped out by the Nazis, and Harry knows of Henry Gerber. Rudy asks Harry for several copies of the call. He figures that since progressives are trying to get signatures for the Stockholm peace petition against the Korean War, he could go out with the same agenda. And they could use this as a way to feel the person out, and if it seems safe to ask, Harry and Rudy would present the idea of a gay organization. So from August to October 1950, the men go to the gay beaches in Santa Monica for signatures. They approach people and bring up the war, and then get into the U.S. government firing homosexuals from work. They say, "Isn't it high time we all got together to do something about it?" Everyone at the gay beaches agrees, but no one wants to put their name on a list and commit their life to it, just like Henry Gerber dealt with 25 years ago in our episode last week. Harry and Lee lay out their ideas for an organization that would establish homosexuals as a minority and the majority. They dream of an amendment to the U.S. Constitution, and it would begin with their organization's underground guilds fighting for it. Harry and Rudy need members, or how can they fight for this? The pair is unable to give up. They're working constantly through 1950. Harry finally feels like he's begun moving back to his true self. They look for opportunities everywhere to bring in members to start their organization.
And finally, about the 1st of November, Rudy one day says to me, "They're getting absolutely nowhere. Are you sure there isn't somebody in one of your classes? Sure, I think you guys in any of your classes?"
In November, while he's teaching music history at the California Labor School for the Communist Party, someone catches Harry's attention. He isn't sure if his student Bob is a homosexual, but he feels pretty certain.
This is Thursday. I have my class Thursday night. So I take in a couple of copies, one for him and one for Chuck.
Chuck is Bob's roommate and former lover. Chuck had campaigned for Henry Wallace, the candidate Harry had tried to rally his gay friends around after that party 2 years ago. Harry swallows hard and clenches his fists, approaching Bob and his friend Chuck with 2 envelopes. After class, Bob and Chuck open the envelopes, and they read the call.
November 11th, 1950, Harry Hay answers the phone discreetly. It's Bob Hull, sounding distant, asking if he can come over.
I said, yeah, and I called him and said, Bob, that's happening, and you better be here.
Soon, Bob, Chuck, and another man are running up the Cove Avenue hillside off Silver Lake Boulevard up to Harry's house.
Afternoon, it was a very windy afternoon. Sometimes windy afternoons can be up there on top of the road. And Chuck, it isn't Bob, it's Chuck who comes running through my driveway. And he's waving me the perspective of his hand and blowing my light flag. He said, I could have written myself when we begin. So he said that.
Harry's introduced to Bob's boyfriend, Dale Jacobs, a playwright and veteran who campaigned for the civil rights of Japanese Americans. Harry brings Bob, Chuck, Dale, and Rudy to the bushy hillside beside Harry's house.
Out over Silver Lake and a beautiful view back towards Burbank on the corner that way in the wind. It's out in the woods out there.
And they talk for hours, swearing each other to secrecy. The five men decide to work with the communist structure they're familiar with, and Harry presents the concept of working from the idea that they are an oppressed cultural minority. They all agree and officially form what they call a Society of Fools, which they would soon rename. The group meets several more times to perfect their ideas.
Figure out where we could begin, what we could do first, and how many other gay guys do we know who might be interested. Figure out a discussion group going, what kind of things would we discuss first, how would we approach this, the whole perspective, all the ideas, and getting wild, the dreams going, wonderful if we could have groups all the way across the country, and the kind of underground days I wish we could do to help the desert group fire in our eyes and fire our dreams. It was too wonderful we'd all found each other.
By day, Harry continues to work in the factory. He also continues to teach his music history class at the labor school, which Bob and Chuck attend. The class starts a study of medieval French Renaissance performers.
Well, in the course of this, I'm going to begin to discover the whole series of societies in medieval France, who were known as Société Joyeuse. Now, Société Joyeuse, insofar as we know, were groups of bachelors who were clerks. In Lyon, in Nîmes, and in Bordeaux, in Marseille, in La Rochelle, in Paris, all various parts of the world, very across the country. And in particular, there was a society that I found terribly interesting, and that was the Société Matachin. And the Société Matachin were a group of masked men. No one ever knew who they were. We don't know anything about their names. We only know that they always appeared masked. We only know that their leader was always known as Mère Sol, which means Mother Pig. Always appeared in woman's dress on stage. They would go out into the countryside and they would perform rituals of protest against oppression in the name of the peasant, because these people could be expendable and the peasantry were not. Families couldn't spare the fathers and kill off the leader. Arms of the lords against whom they were protesting their oppression. But these people could because these were bachelors. And so this was the performance that they did. They went out in the countryside and they set themselves up as the fools who could speak out against oppression. I know who these people are there. They're my antecedents. And this would be wonderful if we were able to do this again. And this is where we are.
Harry presents the same to the men of his new organization, and they all agree they will be called the Mattachine Foundation. In late November, the Mattachine Foundation is ready to try their first strategy and host a discussion group. People are invited discreetly.
There's a girl, there's a friend of Ruby's, and a parent of the friend of Bob's.
The one who gives me the dedication?
Yeah, right. And a black man. Young black man is rare. We have invited about 12 people in these three shows.
Chuck draws the curtains and puts a pillow over the phone to keep possible wiretappers from hearing the discussions. Arriving guests are scheduled to come to the door at different times, and departures are scattered as well in order to keep from drawing attention. The groups begin as invitation-only gatherings, and then those invited are allowed to invite friends. Many people come once or twice and never return. Very few women come, but after noticing the lack of lesbians, people are encouraged to invite more women, including well-known photographer Ruth Bernhardt.
The discussions are the first opportunity many of these homosexuals have to get on the same page with each other. Many of them live with problems they've never discussed openly with anyone before. They exchange stories about coming out to friends or family. They talk about cruising spots, safe bars, and years of living alone.
You know, if you catch me, I really have to do my homework. I better go look at some of those discussion groups, because I have copies of some of those.
I did some of that homework, and Doug got Perry's notes. He wrote down, homosexuals are lone wolves through fear of heterosexual people, and they understandably retreat more within themselves. He goes on, a homosexual has no one to whom he must account, and in the end, he must decide everything for himself. People who attend these meetings are asking questions like, how does one become a homosexual? And are we as sick as medical professionals say we are? Perry notes that their sexual energy isn't for procreating, so perhaps it's to be channeled into creativity. Perhaps society would attack unless people could realize a homosexual's potential ability to offer a worthwhile contribution. Perry continues to listen to their concerns. The guests are understandably curious about where this organization will go. Are we even a minority group? Is it possible to overcome status and isolation and come together? Is this a minority group or just a bunch of people with nothing in common but how we have sex? Perry writes in his notes, those in greatest need are sometimes the most reluctant to help each other or themselves, tending to think of personal experiences as things apart from the mutual effort toward betterment. Perry and his co-founders are persistent. They come to realize, as Harry's notes reported, that homosexuals in general seem unaware of their problems adjusting to society creates a culture in itself. Harry sees that many homosexuals don't see that they are already a social minority. They're a secret society, living among the dominant culture. Harry writes, some glad day there shall be a body of knowledge which will show that homosexuals have much in common. Harry is determined to bring that body of knowledge together. But meanwhile, the FBI, unbeknownst to Harry, his security index card is tabbed for ComSAT, communist sabotage, because he works for a company with a government contract. Just the sort of government monitoring Harry Hay feared. The groups are continuing to meet. These discussion groups are somewhat separate with the actual Mattachine Foundation. People that show up for discussion groups aren't necessarily members of the Mattachine, because most of them haven't heard the word Mattachine and don't know who is running these groups. Harry and his co-founders attend the discussion groups and guide conversations in a casual way that makes it feel informal and spontaneous. People can't figure out who's in charge, so Harry and the co-founders are safe from blame for these meetings should something go wrong. Meanwhile, they discreetly vet these people attending the discussions for membership in the Mattachine, because the Mattachine is a part of their plan for activism outside of the discussion groups. The co-founders notice a pair named Conrad Stevens and James Gruber. This photographer and aspiring teacher speak with passion about homosexuality. The co-founders finally decide to take these two men aside and reveal the Mattachine and the purpose of these discussion groups. Normally, when they reveal the Mattachine to a discussion group attendee, they offer this person membership and a place in the First Order Guild. This is how the Mattachine is inspired by the communist cell structure. No guild knows who the other members are for the safety of everyone. The five men of the Foundation, Harry, Rudy, Bob, Chuck, and Dale, are the fifth order, the top. New members are the first order. As the organization grows, Harry plans to fill in levels of leadership between the first and fifth orders so that people in other cells won't know where the information comes down from. Everyone operates on a safe level of anonymity in case the government infiltrates and begins seeking names of homosexual leaders. But in the case of Conrad and James, Chuck says that it was like magic when they joined. The co-founders offer the pair a place at the top, the fifth quarter, running the Mattachine with them.
Come and Jim come, and immediately it's a hook, and we kind of got set. All of a sudden, when they come to the first discussion group, and the third session, no point in having a discussion group, they go down to the left.
James says he is terrified by it all. The communist language scares him, but the mission of the organization is irresistible to the couple that becomes known by the single nickname Stim. The Mattachine is becoming a group of lovers and former lovers, much like Henry Gerber imagined for the movement. In the spring of 1951, they spend months writing a document stating their missions and purposes in order to catalyze Harry's call to action. To unify, homosexuals isolated from their own kind provide something all of our people can derive a feeling of belonging. To educate both homo and heterosexual people through new information on homosexuality to further research and develop an ethical homosexual culture, paralleling the emerging cultures of other minorities. To lead socially conscious homosexuals to achieve unification. Members stand in a circle and take hands, swearing an oath to work together for equality.
Conduct myself in a way that will reflect credit upon myself and the organization.
To respect the rights of all racial, religion, and national minorities.
To observe the generally accepted social rules of dignity and propriety at all times, in my conduct, attire, and speech.
To strive in every possible way to interest other responsible people.
To participate actively and seriously in the work.
To
unconditionally guard the anonymity of all members of the machine. Our interlocking, sustaining, and protecting hands guarantee a reborn social force of immense and simple purpose.
We are resolved that our people shall find equality of security and production in tomorrow's world.
We are sworn that no boy or girl approaching the maelstrom of deviation need make that crossing alone, afraid, and in the dark ever again.
In these moments, we dedicate ourselves once again
to each other, in the immense significance of such allegiance, with dignity and respect, proud and free.
Bob's boyfriend, co-founder Dale James, will later remember this saying, "To many homosexuals who have lived out years of loneliness and bitterness, believing that his lot in society is a miserable one without hope, the whole proceedings, the sense of group fellowship, the joining of hands and solemn oath, he spoke something so new and of such dazzling implication as to be well-nigh unbelievable." One day, member Geraldine Jackson will say,
"You felt like you had a mission in the world. You felt that you were doing something terribly worthwhile for our people."
Chuck Rowland will later recall,
"No one felt that our rituals were empty, frivolous, or lugubrious.
In the meantime, we're beginning to develop a team. At Christmas, we all, this is a different thing. On Christmas Eve, they all come to my house. And my wife is a little uneasy about all this. There seems to be a closeness in those five that she didn't know about, but wasn't being afraid. And Steve Christian, me and Terry, they're still mentioning Christian and Terry there. And he's very embarrassed. Very embarrassed, because I didn't see him years before, not nowhere. And but anyway, we're all having a ball, singing Christmas carols, all kinds of songs, and a couple of us are doing two cameras stuff and crosses one in line with the other, and we're doing choruses and chorales and this and that. It's very lively and it's very good. It's very pleasant.
The groups grow as summer goes on. When more than about 20 people show up, the foundation splits off the discussion groups to expand the first order. A public meeting sometimes draws in 150 attendees, where the foundation seeks out new Mattachine leaders. They make up a small guidebook explaining how to lead discussions and what topics to cover. Some groups even have same-sex dancing, which isn't allowed by police, but can happen in the privacy of someone's home. The foundation makes a questionnaire for groups, which is several pages long. Few of the people have ever been questioned about their sexual or social lives, and there is endless discussion following. We talk about how things can be changed, and how a gay subculture can grow, how to change social attitudes, and the strengths they have learned by surviving in this world.
What we're trying to do, we're trying to find out what is the nature of our relationship. And we don't have words for it, we don't have anybody else. We're talking about a possibility. And the whole concept of a group is such a, it still doesn't matter, but it's something that is sort of PSP. Come together and get this sense of brotherhood. We get this sense of belonging. This sense of being together, which is so different from prison.
There are mass arrests and bar raids out there, loss of jobs, and an impossibility to protest these things publicly. People are terrified that the government will get a list of names and the cop will come banging down the door of the discussion groups and arrest everyone. Almost all attendees use pseudonyms, no matter how comfortable these discussions become. But there are never raids on the meetings. They become a safe space for gays who fear bar raids and unsafe places in gay subculture. One woman in the first order may recall,
"People were able to bloom and be themselves. It was something we didn't know before. At last, there was the opportunity to say what you wanted to say, and feel accepted.
Rupert later said, all of us had done a whole lifetime of not talking, of repression, just the freedom to open up, that's what it was all about. We had found a sense of belonging, of camaraderie, of openness, and an atmosphere of tension and distrust. A family feeling came out of it, a non-sexual emphasis. It was a brand new idea, just that is what kept the organization going. And Gruber is right. Initially, this family feeling is what will keep the organization fighting when society begins to take notice of them. Before these growing groups can really take off, an unnamed informant contacts the FBI. This informant tells the Bureau that Chuck and Bob are homosexuals and are living together. The informant claims to know this because he is also a homosexual, and he too is a dissociated communist brought into the party by Bob. Now Chuck and Bob are also out of the party, likely expelled for their sexuality. The FBI takes note of Mattachine co-founders Bob Hull and Chuck Rowland, marking their sexuality down in their FBI files under health. Bob and Chuck don't know the FBI is watching. Luckily, the organization is moving slow and keeping private. Their next discreet but vital step is finding a lawyer. This lawyer has left a gay friend on a charge, and he helps the foundation get a preliminary charter to start a non-profit corporation. Within a year, Harry felt that organizing the Mattachine was a call to me deeper than the innermost reaches of the spirit, a vision quest more important than life. So he goes to his Communist Party leadership and explains his call and recommends his own expulsion.
I've said I can no longer pretend to something that is no longer so. I must come out in my for what I am, for who I am, and must understand this, I must appreciate it.
Because he's been dedicated to them for 18 years and taught for them, they only dropped him as a security risk, but as a lifelong friend of the people.
And I didn't think that I have had all this magnificent experience and training in organization and in struggle. And I think my own people are going to need this. And how wonderful that I have gotten could not have passed at all.
Next, Harry tells his family.
Yeah, it's in September 1959. When I tell my wife what is happening and the type of group that I'm organizing, and she immediately said, oh, this could grow and it could certainly hit the newspapers for the kinds of activities that you are taking, and the children will be in danger.
And you can tell us, Harry.
You know, I suddenly realized you never know everything you are going to be part of this party. I think that in order for them to remain secure as possible, secure as possible good, that they should be left intact, that the, none of the people and friends that I knew, I should contact none. That I would leave the family with these people surrounding them, giving them comfort, and I would simply withdraw. So that all of the people that I had met, all the people that I knew over all those years, I never went back to again, I never saw anything again. I never explained, I left. I go out through whatever explanations she wanted, whatever children used, whatever explanation she wanted. And I didn't interfere with it at all. So I didn't see them. I didn't even see my brother in his life. 13 years.
Harry gives his life over to the Mattachine for the good of the movement.
Well, it was absolutely necessary. You see, the thing was that I didn't know at that time, but it occurred to me that because of my connections in the party, because of my teaching, because of the fact that the conspiracy trials were already beginning to happen in New York, and we knew it was only a matter of time before they'd happen in California, I could very well be called into the conspiracy trials under the Smith Act. The Communist Party leaders are being accused of a conspiracy to sort of government by force and violence. I was a very prominent teacher, a prominent educator, so that I could be called in, and I didn't have no way of knowing what the FBI knew and didn't know. So that they could call me in relation to Amtrak workers too. And consequently, if there was a possibility that it would be, it would make a lovely juicy story. We knew that it would make a lovely scandalous story. So
when he isn't working at the factory, his life is consumed by the work at the foundation. It's time to allow the first order discussion groups to thrive on their own and turn the fifth order toward the call to action. When brutal LA police harassment of the Chicano community begins getting attention in the press, the city of Los Angeles holds hearings due to pressure for investigation into police practices. The Mattachine Foundation attends the hearing to speak in favor of disciplinary action and support of minorities fighting police brutality. Harry moves out of his home. At Harry Hayes' former home, a set of concrete stairs leads up from Cove Avenue through the bushes to the top of that hill, beginning with a sign that says, "The Mattachine Steps." Harry Hay founded the Mattachine Society on this hillside on November 11, 1950. He spends the next year actively meeting his people, addressing problems within the community, and strategizing how to help us all. He writes down in those discussion meeting notes, "Homosexuals do not understand themselves, and thus it is not surprising that heterosexuals do not understand them either." The Mattachine Foundation becomes determined against that, even within the splintering of their own personal relationships. By spring 1952, Dale and Bob break up. Dale's feeling down, he goes out to see a movie. He passes on a couple films showing that he doesn't care to see, and around 9 p.m. he stops off in Westlake Park, now called MacArthur Park, near downtown L.A., to use the toilet. In the restroom, a man puts his hand on Dale's crotch, but Dale isn't interested in cruising. He leaves the restroom and heads home. The big, rough guy falls behind him. Dale speeds up, trying to lose him at each corner. When he gets home, the man pushes his way inside Dale's apartment, insisting on sleeping with Dale. Dale continues to resist until the man pulls out his badge and handcuffs him. "Maybe you'll talk better with my partner outside," the man says. Dale Jennings is arrested and hauled to the police station, and the Mattachine Foundation finds itself at a time for action. Next week on Mattachine.